Hi, this is Kim Shanley for Tennis Reach. Today we're doing our sixth in our series of the Federer Forehand Paradigm Series. And by far, this is the most important lesson. There's going to be a lot of things that are different about this lesson than any lesson I think that you've ever seen. Yes, at the end of it, you'll know some secrets that you can apply to your game today, but it's really going to be much bigger than that. It's going to be worth 100 quick tips, I promise. The first way it's going to be different than any other tennis lesson that you've seen is it's going to be much longer. I know, my friends tell me, Kim, you're never going to make any money at this business with these long videos, and man, they may be right. But my answer is that this is not just something you can say in 30 seconds or even 5 minutes. The second way this lesson will be different than any you've seen is that I'm just really going to talk to you directly as members of this audience. I'm going to ask for your patience. It's going to take some patience to work through this, but I think you'll want to see the evidence along the way of what I'm proposing. The third way this video is going to be different than any other tennis lesson you've seen is that I'm going to include a lot of essentially footnotes and background evidence. Now, some of this is too detailed to see as we proceed on a flow through the presentation, and I'll just hit the highlights. But I will provide the detailed note slides at the end so you can go back and look at those and do your own research, check things out on your own. The fourth way this lesson is going to be different than any other lesson you've seen is, at least from me, is that I'm going to go into a little bit of detail about my background so you can see where these ideas are coming from and how they evolve. So if I haven't lost you by now, stick around, it's going to be an exciting ride. The title of this lesson is A New Tennis Paradigm, and first I want to explain how I arrived at this idea. Basically, I started looking around beyond the silo walls of tennis, especially into the other major hitting sports, baseball and golf, to see what I can learn about what coaches are saying in those sports about the swing and hitting. And what I found is that they're saying something completely different than what we're saying in tennis, and that the sports science and the investment in science and objective study in these two sports is far beyond what we've done in tennis. So there's a lot of evidence that they brought to bear that we can now use to understand what we're saying about in tennis. On the screen in a moment will be one of these detailed note slides that I referred to. Here are some of the top golf and baseball online sites I found in my research. A couple highlights. First, there are some great new coaching tools like TrackMan in golf that provide coaches with instant objective video and analysis of sports actions that are impossible to analyze in real time. These tools are expensive, and to date, they are not available to tennis coaches. If the Advanced Player Development Program in your country, and here in the United States it's the USTA, wants to improve tennis, I suggest that they could invest in these type of tools and make them available to coaches all over the country. Again, don't be worried about absorbing all the details of these research and notes pages as I present them at first. I'm going to give them to you again at the end, and you can take your time going through them. I will point out, however, that the best source for objective video analysis is at player.net. This is an excellent tennis instruction site run by John Yandell, who was our first editor at my old publication, Tennis One. John has been a pioneer and champion of tennis video analysis and deserves a lot of credit for this. He started our video archive at Tennis One, and now our archive is hosted on his site. So check out player.net when you want objective video resources. On the next slide, you'll see the summary of my tennis journey and my background so we understand a little bit more about where this new tennis paradigm idea came from. While I've been a tennis player all my life, I should first say I grew up watching the wide world of sports on TV, and our family received Sports Illustrated each week. So while I love tennis, and always have, I also love most other sports, and this sort of universal love of sport, it is an important part of the background and the reasons for this paradigm idea. Many of you on the channel have mentioned Doug King and said, "Do I know Doug King?" And it sounds a little bit familiar with what you're talking about. So yes, I do know Doug King. He was a senior writer for over 15 years at Tennis One, where I was the founder and publisher of Tennis One for over 20 years. And I used to spend long days at Doug King's house in Napa, California, where we filmed hundreds of articles for Tennis One and over 15 DVDs and online tennis courses. Doug and his wife were kind enough to put me up at their house during my visits. So Doug and I usually talked about tennis filming ideas over breakfast, reviewed those notes over lunch, filmed in the afternoon, worked on our tennis games a little bit later in the afternoon, and had beers discussing the day's work, ending with Doug's living room with a glass of wine in one hand and demonstrating some tennis technique with a racquet in the other. So over the years of working with Doug, who was once the former number one open player in Northern California, I learned his unique vision of the tennis swing. So a good deal of what I have to say about the new tennis paradigm comes from him. And I learned a little something from the hundreds of top tennis coaches and writers who published on Tennis One over the years. But particularly, I want to mention my senior editor, Dave Smith. Dave is one of the great coaches in the world. He's published two best-selling tennis instruction books, Tennis Mastery and Coaching Mastery. Dave has also been one of the best high school tennis coaches in the United States. And at one point in his stellar career, his 20-year high school record was 700 wins versus 9 losses. And this was in Los Angeles, one of the most competitive tennis areas in the country. Filmed two long online courses with Dave, among other DVDs and courses, about developing championship-level players and teams. They say it takes 10,000 hours of deliberate practice to become an expert in anything, something we'll discuss further in our series. However, Dave Smith showed me how highly skilled players could be developed in less than 1,000 hours of practice. All the players who stuck in Dave's 4-year program, and he could only work with them 3 months a year, became 4-5 or 4-5 plus players, many going on to play college or the pros. Dave had a teaching system which he called the Advanced Foundation, which produced excellence in a relatively short period. More on this later, but my understanding of how to develop tennis players quickly to a high level of skill, well, a lot of that credit goes to my understanding that I got from Dave Smith. And finally, well, I want to give thanks to Doug King and Dave Smith and all the Tennis One contributors that I learned from. I want to make clear that I'm speaking for myself now. There's not everything that I'm saying in this new series that everyone's going to agree upon for sure. I know Doug King didn't even like to use the word swing. I think it's okay to use that word, which I'll explain as the series goes on. This next slide in my background, and we're going to get through this as quickly as possible, is about my time as a researcher, which is a kind of a strange thing for a tennis coach to talk about, but it's really the truth. It's really a lot of my reading about other sports, other coaches, and other books, really, that have given me a little bit of different perspective, perhaps, than others. What I'd like to draw your attention to now is the bottom of the slide where I talk about movement research. I hear a lot of tennis coaches say that tennis is a moving and hitting sport. And while I agree with that, I never seen reference to what I call the big four movement thinkers noted here. I think these four thinkers, each of whom created their own movement and learning system, provide an insight into the basics of human movement that can improve tennis movement and tennis instruction. I'll be using some of their ideas in explaining this new tennis paradigm. So in terms of answering your question, Kim, where the heck is all this coming from? My answer in part is coming from the big four movement thinkers of the last century, Feldenkrais, Alexander, Laban, and Pilates. Finally, the last slide on my background and tennis reach and our mission statement, the art of tennis. Really, this comes from my love of the wide world of sports and all my publishing, coaching, and research. I've always had this idea there was a deeper level to access in terms of tennis technique beyond simply getting from 3-5 to 4-0 or beating the next guy or girl. And this just took me a long time, 25 years really, to get to an understanding of what this other level was all about. And without further ado, let me present that. I'm calling this a new tennis paradigm. So before we go any further, I need to explain more closely what a paradigm is. And here we have a quote from business guru Stephen Covey. And Covey's idea is that if you really want to change the world, you have to look at paradigms. Why? Because paradigm is a worldview, the whole framework and context for how you understand the world and how the world works for you. For example, for 2,000 years, man's paradigm for building a flying machine was based on copying how birds flap their wings. It wasn't that people were dumb for 2,000 years. Even the most brilliant minds like Leonardo da Vinci were convinced that man would have to copy the way birds flap their wings in order for man to fly. But because the underlying paradigm was wrong, man never successfully built a flying machine, not once, in 2,000 years of trying by all the best minds. So getting the paradigm right, getting the underlying principle right, is absolutely critical in making anything work in the real world. And if the paradigm or principle is wrong, the application of the principle will turn out wrong as well. Now, the tricky part about paradigms, or at least faulty paradigms, is sometimes they seem to produce the right results. What do I mean? For example, I mean the idea of bloodletting, the idea that there were bad humors in the blood of sick people, and we had to drain that blood out of the sick patient to make them healthy, was 100% incorrect. But again, for over 2,000 years, doctors didn't understand the true underlying ideas behind sickness. And sometimes, after bleeding a patient, the patient would recover. The doctors concluded, well, bloodletting worked, at least sometimes, so let's keep doing it. And they did, contributing to the death of countless sick patients, including our first president, George Washington, who doctors drained nearly 40% of his blood when he came down with a heavy cold or flu after horseback riding. And no surprise, Washington died the same day. And that leads me directly to the paradigm that I'm presenting. I think we have a faulty paradigm operating in the tennis domain, which I'm calling the linear swing paradigm. And I think our rationale for continuing with this faulty paradigm is the same as our rationale for continuing with bloodletting all those years. Well, the reasoning is sometimes it works. And in the next slide coming up, we see the results from my research that none of the leading coaches in golf or baseball, the other leading hitting sports in the United States anyway, agree with us about the linear swing model. In fact, all the leading golf and tennis coaches have adopted the rotational swing model as the foundation of their games. In golf and baseball, they have invested in the scientific research. They have instrumented the golf club and baseball bat using modern high-speed video and scientific tools to study the swing, and have concluded that the swing is essentially a rotational action. Moreover, they all agree that trying to swing in a linear fashion is among the chief flaws in the swinging motion. Now, I'll let this slide stay up on the screen for a little bit so that you can think about the statement a bit more. To be blunt, tennis is alone in thinking that the linear swing is the correct model. We are alone, and that being alone should give us pause within the tennis teaching world and get us to take a second look at what we're saying and teaching about the linear swing.
Rather than just talk about this linear swing model, let me show you how people think about it. And you can see tennis pros demonstrating this all the time. While players and coaches clearly see the rotational nature of the take-back and follow-through, they believe the racquet gets lined up in a linear way behind the ball before contact. And then in a good swing, in their view, the racquet proceeds in a linear manner, contacting the ball and even continuing this linear path to the target long after the ball has left the racquet. They even talk about envisioning three balls in a row and hitting those after contact. They believe that this type of linear swing will give the player the best contact possible, even producing a heavy hit on the ball as they see contact from this linear paradigm. But we'll see shortly that while players try to perform this linear motion in the long extension after contact, it's a faulty paradigm that produces flat, no-spin type of contact that generates many more errors than necessary.
At this point, I know that some of my viewers and some of the coaches out there are objecting to the presentation I'm making already, saying, Kim, I've never heard about this linear swing model. It's not something that I teach or was taught to me. You know, we just learn how to play tennis and we teach it the best that we can. So if you want to stop this video at this point and do some research, you can do a Google search for, quote, ATP Forehands YouTube and pull up at least a dozen tennis videos where the pro will describe this linear swing model in some manner or form. Or you can do this research at the end of my video where I'll include this reminder page. And I also anticipate a second major objection to my idea here is that, Kim, if you're saying that we're teaching the wrong model, how can we produce such great tennis champions? So it doesn't make any sense. Well, my answer is the tennis world is in a bubble. So why are we in a bubble? First, we tend to think of tennis as a better sport than any other. I know I did. And therefore, we really don't pay much attention to these other sports. So we stay within our own learning silo or bubble. Secondly, we continue to operate this faulty paradigm because many of the assumptions behind this paradigm are unconscious. Ask the average teaching pro what swing model they use, and they'll look at you with a complete blank face. What swing model, they'll say, we teach tennis here, which usually means the way that they've always been taught. So it's hard to have a rational debate or argument with someone who denies the very existence of the idea. So people do have an underlying concept about how to swing. Otherwise, they couldn't even move, much less swing the racket or at a moving ball. But this concept is largely unconscious. And this concept is tied to an even deeper unconscious feeling about safety and security. This is where an understanding of the big four movement thinkers of the last century comes into play. Feldenkrais, Alexander, Laban, and Pilates all agreed that movement, even the most fundamental movements, reflect the inner person and the conditioned way this person grew up and learned to move. They also agree that when under pressure or threat, human beings typically revert to movements that they believe have kept them safe and secure in the past, to what's worked in the past. This is often why trying to get someone to change or improve their tennis game is so difficult. People have to give up an old, safe, and secure model they've been operating on all of their life. Another reason we have this bubble and this faulty paradigm is really a simplistic one, which is that the swing, especially at the end, is just too fast to see in real time. And so this leads to a lot of casual speculation about what's happening at contact. And we really can't see beneath that until we watch it in slow motion. And my answer to those who say, how can we produce great tennis players and champions if we have a faulty swing model? Well, my answer is that it works sometimes, just like bloodletting, and that most pros have adopted what I call a hybrid linear rotational model that works even a little better than the linear model. So it works sometimes, but that doesn't make it a good model for us to base our teaching on. Before we take a look at the hybrid linear rotational swing of the pros, let's just take a quick look at the linear model as shown by a 3-5 or 4-0 player. This player begins her stroke by quickly splitting her hands and pointing her racket tip directly back to the back fence. She wants to hit a topspin forehand, but she initiates her swing with the racket above her contact point. So she has a very flat, horizontal swing to the ball. If she moves through contact, she pushes the racket slowly up and through, extending the racket in a linear manner to the target. It's a very weak swing that doesn't produce much speed or topspin. Now, what does the hybrid linear rotational model look like on the professional level? Here is Maria Sharapova hitting one of her forehands. And I think on her forehand, she shows you a good example of this linear rotational swing model. In other words, it's halfway between a linear and a rotational stroke. Sharapova has the same early split hands take back as the 3-5 player, with the tip of the racket extended way back, pointing to the back fence. And she begins a huge swing forward and around from this linear extension of her hitting arm. And through this sequence, you can see the linear to the target elements of her body and swinging action. She gets her racket lined up behind the incoming ball early, and then pushes the racket through contact, and has a very extended push of this racket linearly towards the target. Of course, this is long after the ball has left the racket. Does this work? Has it worked for Maria Sharapova? Obviously, she has won 5 Grand Slams, so it has worked, at least worked well enough. But here I list all the negatives of this type of swing. First, the linear preparation of the body reduces the body torque and power of the swing. Next, this linear push through contact zone slows the racket down, reducing power. Third, this kind of swing produces a flat, no-spin sort of contact. Fourth, early or late squaring of the racket at contact is quite often the case, and this produces more errors than if. Now, given the state of tennis statistics, it's a little hard to prove some of these statements. So how can we look at the statement that this kind of swing produces more errors? In terms of errors, we all keep track in tennis of what we call unforced errors. But if we kept track of the margin of errors, I think the flaws in technique and paradigms would show up more clearly. What do I mean? I mean, it's quite usual to see players with the linear rotational swing model to hit the ball 5 to 10 feet out when committing an error. On the serve, it's not uncommon to see more than 10 double faults, and serves that hit the middle of the net or 5 to 10 feet out of the service box. I believe this level of margin of error shows an underlying problem with the swing technique, typically a paradigm problem. You never saw Pete Sampras, or you never see Roger Federer commit more than 10 double faults in a match. You never see Federer, Djokovic, or Nadal, all of whom have a rotational swing pattern, hit balls 5 to 10 feet out regularly when they make an error. Typically, they miss by inches. And this really is a timing error, but their underlying swing model is sound. And the final reason that I'm listing that I think we're in a bubble and have a faulty paradigm is what I call the good is the enemy of great. The basic idea is that if players feel that good is enough, they won't continue to work to become great. In my 25 years of publishing and coaching within the tennis world, too often I've seen a good enough rationale coming from our top tennis players and coaches. I'll have more to say about this in subsequent articles, but just one story. I was coaching a top junior player, a college level scholarship player. I worked many hours on a detailed side-by-side analysis of his serve and forehand, comparing him to 2 great pros. I gave him the presentation, and I didn't hear back from him. So I asked him, "Did you get it?" He said, "Yes." And I said, "Well?" He said, "I agree." And then he dropped it. He had no interest in pursuing the path of greatness. He was good enough. I think that's a shame and very discouraging, but we'll pick up this topic later. So if this paradigm is so faulty, Kim, why do we continue to use it? Well, I would say it's the same reason we continued to believe in the flapping of the wings paradigm for flight and the bloodletting for curing sickness. Largely, this idea was unconscious. It's just the way things are, the way we were taught. And yeah, in terms of bloodletting, sometimes it works, or works well enough. So we continue to use it mostly in an unconscious level. So let's look at the negative effects of this linear swing model on the serve. And for some in our audience, this is a bit of a repeat of a past lesson I presented, but I think it bears repeating. As it is, I believe it's a very clear demonstration of what's wrong with the linear swing model on the serve. Here we have a past great player and champion. In fact, the number one women's player in the world at one point, Dinara Safina. And here we see Dinara, a great and powerful athlete, in the classic trophy position for the serve. Nothing wrong here. She looks like the model on a tennis trophy. But in the next frames of this high-speed video that we shot, we start to see a big problem developing in Safina's serve motion. The linear swing model encourages a player to prematurely pivot towards the target in preparation for the swing through to the target fashion. And here we see Safina prematurely pivoting to the front, opening up too soon. By the time we get to slide number 5, we see how much Safina has pivoted to the front, how much her shoulders have leveled, and her upper torso and chest are levering down, which will drag the racket down through the contact zone. And instead of hitting up on the serve, which will produce the proper topspin and trajectory over the net, she's dragging it through in a downward fashion. In slide 7, the start of the follow-through, we see the telltale signs of the linear swing model. This is this extended forward thrust of the racket towards the target. And in slide 8, we see the last part of Safina's follow-through. So what's wrong with the service motion? Well, Dinara Safina is one of the featured pros in this ESPN article, Why Can't Women Serve? It was quite common for Safina to serve 10 or more double faults in a match, and her serving problems undermined her confidence, and she soon quit the game altogether. A real shame. She was a great athlete and could have been a great champion. So this headline, Why Can't Women Serve, has been running just about each year for the last 10 years. Here in 2017 is the New York Times headline, and we can see the latest version of this. So for the last 10 years, TV pundits and tennis journalists have been complaining that the top professional women can't serve. Now, think about that. Just imagine if we had an article running every year saying that ballet dancers can't dance or that chess masters can't play chess. There's really something fundamentally wrong here. And for 10 years, there's been no answer from the tennis journalists or TV pundits, at least no good answer about why women can't serve. And with all due respect to Lindsay Davenport, the idea that the top pros in the women's game don't take pride in serving is kind of silly. They have their professional careers on the line and millions of dollars at stake. It doesn't make sense that they don't care enough to try to get their serves right. I say we don't have a work ethic problem or a mental toughness problem here. We have a paradigm problem. And the paradigm problem is this linear swing paradigm model that players are basing their technique on. Again, like most paradigms, most of the elements of the paradigm are unconscious. And again, because the swing action through contact is so fast and the action so quick, it's almost impossible to see with the naked eye, except for the results, the ball going into the net or out of the service box. Even with slow motion analysis, if your mind is conditioned to see the swing in a linear as a linear action, you'll see a linear swing, even though the actual motion is rotational. As the big four movement thinkers all said, we see or do things as we are conditioned to see and experience them. So I still see some viewers might be objecting, saying, hey Kim, I've seen plenty of great linear swings. In fact, last week I think I saw a linear swing on Tennis Reach. So really, what are you talking about? Here's a good example. This is from a video lesson on Tennis Reach last week. On the surface, it seems to show a linear swing path for Roger Federer on his forehand. But this was a shot from a side angle. Let's take a closer look from behind. This is Roger Federer's forehand shot with my high-speed camera at 300 frames per second. First, I'll just play this through, then we'll go through the frames slowly, frame by frame, to really zero in on whether Federer has a linear or a rotational swing. So let's put a red dot on the sweet spot of his racket where he'll make contact with the ball and a blue dot at the end of the handle of his racket. Now let's subtract all the photos of Federer and just look at the pattern of red dots. which is the pattern of his racquet swing path. Now we can see clearly that Federer's racquet swing path is a rotational action, not a perfectly circular action, but certainly nothing like a linear straight to the target swing that so many coaches teach their players. Now let's add in the blue dots, which captures the path of Federer's hand on the racquet. Of course, we see a matching or mirror image of the racquet swing, a rotational action. We see in this view that the linear direction of the ball towards the target is the result of a rotational racquet and hand action by the player, this being Roger Federer. In fact, you'll see that right after contact, Federer's hand moves up and to the left, not linearly towards the target. And we see the same action in the rotational swing in golf and baseball. Before we look at the golf and baseball swing, let me have a chance to give a few clarifications about this rotational model. First of all, the one really good exception of this is the buggy whip forehand, where the racquet ends up on the same side as the hitting action. Now, there is a brief moment where there's a more linear action through contact on the buggy whip forehand. However, it is not a straight to the target action, as it's a quick upward brushing action, and we actually see the racquet kind of twirl above the player's head at the end. So it's rotational to start. Yes, a brief moment of brushing up like an uppercut, but this is not a straight punch action that we see in karate or sometimes in boxing. The second clarification to the rotational model is the linear drive of the hitting arm from the static slot to the dynamic slot, at least for the Federer, Nadal, and Djokovic forehand. We do see this linear drive of the arm with the tip of the racquet held back, traveling from the static slot to the dynamic slot, where the real swing or rotational movement of the racquet around the body and forward begins. So this linear 45 degree arm drive is part of the stroke, but really not part of the swing. And in the next slide, I'm trying to further clarify why choosing the right paradigm is so critical. Because you could argue that Maria Sharapova has won 5 Grand Slams, so let's copy her technique. But as you can see, her forehand technique with this big, slow swinging action is a far cry from the more efficient, more compact, faster, and lesser prone Federer forehand swing. The final clarification I want to make about the rotational model is regarding the linear weight shift in the body in the forehand stroke. There is definitely a linear back and forth shift of weight to the rear foot and then back to forward. But this linear element of the overall forehand stroke is quickly converted to a rotating hip, torso, and arm action. The essence of the model is going on now to look at the baseball swing. Here we have yours truly swinging a baseball bat to a ball on a tee. The shot is from the rear, just like I shot Roger Federer, and I'm using the same camera set at the same 300 frames per second. So let's take a quick pass through this. And then back to a frame-by-frame look, putting a red dot on the sweet spot of the bat where contact is made, and a blue dot on the handle of the bat. And when we subtract out the photo content at the bat swing path, we see a rotational action. No, it's not as round and circular as the tennis swing we see with Roger Federer, but it's certainly not a linear swing to the target. In fact, in baseball and in golf, the linear swing is considered one of the chief flaws of swinging. So in baseball, they call this casting. So the arms are usually in the setup something like this. And for beginning players who haven't been taught to swing properly, they tend to throw out their arms in this idea of getting the barrel of the bat in line with the incoming baseball, just like beginning and relatively unskilled tennis players want to get the racquet lined up and go through the target. So this casting of the bat out, casting of the racquet out, is one of the chief flaws in swinging, because we simply don't have the rotational twisting and torquing that has to come closer to the body in order to move the bat through quickly into contact or the racquet. Now let's look at the golf swing. Again, same setup, me hitting a golf ball filmed from behind at 300 frames per second. And we'll be putting a red dot on the face of the club where contact will be made with the golf ball, and a blue dot at the end of the handle of the golf club. Again, subtracting out the photo content and just viewing the path of the golf club head, we see another version of a rotational swing. Obviously one more vertical than we saw in tennis and baseball, because we always make contact in golf with the ball sitting at our feet. And in baseball, and especially in tennis, we make contact with the ball at various heights. And just as in baseball, that the linear swing is one of the chief flaws, the linear swing model is one of the chief flaws, if not the primary problem in golf swings. What do I mean by that? Well, the golf club is taken back, and then when the player gets up here, suddenly this idea of safety and security starts to come into play. They want to get this club head lined up with this golf ball down here so they think they can hit it towards the target, towards the camera. So what they do is they start to turn prematurely. It's called coming over the top. And the swing becomes initiated much too early in the stroking motion. This is exactly what we have with the tennis linear model, where the racquet is extended way back here. The player gets anxious about contact and then tries to line up too soon to make contact with the ball. So the other major flaw in golf anyway is using the same term as they do in baseball, which is casting of the hands. So if we're back here, we're way out of line with this linear target. And so the player becomes anxious, reverts to this old model that we talked about for safety and security, and extends the hands out, casts the hands out too soon, trying to get the club head lined up, or the golf head lined up, with this linear swing idea. So what are the three swings? Tennis, golf, and baseball look side by side? Here you go. These are all different, but they all show rotation, and rotation is the DNA of the swing. This is one of those universals that lie beneath the different sporting actions. In fact, this idea of a universal rotating action of the body as representative of athletic action goes back thousands of years. And here we see Discobolus, or discus thrower, a Greek statue, the symbol of the Olympic Games, representing the ideal of athletic form. What does this rotational action produce? It produces all the dynamic actions we need in sport. Rotational spiraling movement, coiled springy power, smooth kinetic chain transfer of energy and power, and rotating acceleration and whip-like release. And in the modern era of anatomy and physiology, we've learned that when we peel back the skin, we see a human body composed of spiraling muscles that power spiraling rotating actions that's involved with the rotational movement. Summing up now, we see the essence of the swing as this rotating action on a plane. And depending on how much topspin the player wants to impart in tennis, will dictate how vertical the plane is, with Federer, Novak, Djokovic, and Rafa Nadal, we see a much more vertical swing plane than we typically see in other pro players, and certainly any club players, which typically have a very shallow approach to the ball, a very flat kind of swing. I've also included this old swing plane diagram of the legendary golfer Ben Hogan on the right to once again show the universality of these sporting actions, this swing on a plane. Ben Hogan was said to have the best swing in golf history, and this was how he viewed the swinging action. And we've already traced this swing path in our previous golf slow motion demonstration. Swing plane is huge. On a more abstract level, this concept of the rotating body, the rotating core, the loading of the hips, shoulders, torso, the buildup and release of lag in the arm into a fast action for throwing or hitting, or in the case of discus throwing, throwing the discus. This is a underlying universal that we can all appreciate better once we see the full wide world of sports and start to get a deeper appreciation for and a deeper skill set built around it. How serious am I about accessing the inner discus thrower in us? Well, it's a playful idea, and we do see at tennis tournaments, professional tournaments, how players will throw a football around or they've kicked the soccer ball around. So throwing a discus around is not that much of a stretch. And I like this image of the discus thrower because it connects us from the tennis silo, you know, right into the Olympic Games and the ideal of athletic action. We can see from Steph Curry of the Golden State Warriors, who I'll talk about in a minute, how he uses other sports to bring a touch of playfulness, touch of grace, touch of balance into the development of his basketball technique. I call that the art of basketball, and certainly we can use it to inspire us in the art of tennis. We've come a long way in this presentation of the new tennis paradigm. So let's pause for a moment and summarize all the major takeaways. The first takeaway is simply that paradigms, models, guide our view and our movements. Secondly, to paraphrase from the movie Speed, technique will only get you so far, and then it will get you dead or injured or stuck. If we keep asking a body designed for rotational action to perform in a linear way, we're just asking for injury. Third major takeaway is we have a faulty paradigm, this linear swing model operating in the tennis domain. Fourth, the other major hitting sports, golf and baseball, have long adopted a rotational swing paradigm and consider the linear swing actions to be major flaws. Fifth, the answer to the question, why can't women serve, is, in my opinion, the faulty linear swing paradigm. Sixth, the margin of errors of players with a faulty paradigm is much greater than players with a correct paradigm. Seventh, players revert to old faulty models which they perceive as safe when under pressure. Eight, none of the other major hitting sports advocate teaching beginning students a faulty swing model and expect them to develop or evolve to a correct model. We often hear this from tennis professionals that, you know, the advanced techniques can't be taught to club players, beginning players, that it's too advanced for them. The timing issues are too difficult. But can you imagine in golf that the golfing instructor for a beginning student would instruct the golfer to start off learning a linear swing like this and then say, well, 5 years from now, you'll be more mature, you'll have hit a lot of tennis golf balls, and eventually you'll learn to swing properly. Now, no sport, no art begins by teaching its beginning students the wrong technique, but we do in tennis. The timing of the hit, which is just an essential part of hitting sports, is built into some built into the very nature of the sport, and we should learn and practice this from the very beginning. Then we won't have to go back and change our models and relearn things that we should have learned from the beginning. The rotational swing paradigm has some linear body and racket movements, but the essential body action and swing path are rotational. 11, tennis coaches can learn from coaches in sports science and other sports. And finally, it's my belief that tennis players can learn from this wider world of sports, that they can start to understand at a greater depth the athletic action that's underneath their technique and help guide them into improvement that technique in their sport. And we're inspired by the examples of our great champions, especially Novak Djokovic, Roger Federer, Rafael Nadal, who kept learning and improving even though they're great. And from other champions in other sports, my favorite being Steph Curry. Now Steph Curry, as some of you may know, when he's warming up for a basketball game, practices all kinds of different sports, from bowling actions to baseball hitting actions, the golf actions, and he starts to understand a little piece of this universal equation. So Steph uses these other sports to refresh his spirit, refresh his body, refresh his imagination about how he's going to evolve his basketball technique. So I think we've tried the mono culture of tennis, the repetitive learning model to exhaustion, you know, repeating the same thing over and over again, hoping that over the years that people's technique will improve, when it really is a paradigm issue underneath that needs to change at the beginning. Once we have the paradigm correct, improvement can happen very rapidly. I saw this with Dave Smith, myself. I've seen it in my own coaching. It doesn't take that long once you have the right paradigm to make quick improvements. Yes, it takes time to become great, but we have to start at the paradigm level. Of course, there's a lot of details about implementing this rotational forehand swing model and rotational swing model in general, but before you go today, I want you to go out and try to start experimenting with this right away. There's no reason to wait. You're really going to have to experience this new model yourself in order to really get a feel for it. So the first tip is forget about the linear swing model. You know, we don't line up and push through, okay? So commit yourself to a rotational action and commit yourself to a whip-like release through contact where we're turning on the ball. And the directionality is taken care of by the timing of this turn. So we don't want to hesitate once we get here, but this is full on, okay? Full on, where we're whipping the racket through in this rotational manner. The second part of this tip, which goes back to the swing plane idea that you saw in the presentation, is that most players, even at the professional level, tend to initiate the swing from too high a position. In other words, there's not enough verticality in their swing path. And this creates all kinds of problems in terms of trying to manipulate contact by rolling over and producing topspin that way. One of the best pieces of advice from my old coach Dave Smith is keep the plane the same. So once you commit to this more vertical swing path, keep on it. Don't try to manipulate things, scoop or roll over at the point of contact. If you make a mistake, you make a mistake, but you'll learn the right swing path. So we see this with all the great Federer, Nadal, Djokovic. They all have a much more vertical swing plane than the average player. And they make a lot fewer errors as well. So give this rotational model a tryout. Don't hesitate. Get the swing plane more vertical and keep the plane the same.